name is Aaron, and I'm an event facilitator here at McNally Robinson Booksellers. I would like to begin by acknowledging that we are on Treaty 1 territory, and that the land on which we gather is the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Cree, Oji-Cree, Dakota, and Dene people, and the homeland of the Métis Nation. In addition, McNally Robinson Booksellers rests on the land that was once occupied by the Métis community of Roostertown. On behalf of the store, and with thanks to Rutledge, I would like to thank you for joining us as we celebrate the launch of A Marxist History of Capitalism by Henry Heller. Henry Heller is a professor of history at the University of Manitoba. His short account of the history of capitalism combines Marx's economic and political thought with contemporary scholarship to shed light on the current capitalist crisis. The book provides an overview of the different historical stages of capitalism, underpinned by the accessible discussions of its theoretical foundations. To tell me more, or to tell us more, please join me in welcoming Henry Heller.
Well, I think I'll start by noting the cover of the book and these remarkable characters are memorialized in stone. And I happen to see this statue is in Berlin, and when I saw it, I immediately decided to make it the cover of my book. And the best thing about this book is its cover. So I think I'll start by noting that. I've just returned from China, and I was in Nanjing and Beijing at two universities, and I was gave two lectures on the substance of the book, and I think I'll begin by talking a little bit about China and so on, because China does figure in the book toward the end. As everybody knows, the rise of China is extremely important, and it has all kinds of implications. And it is notable that no sooner was the book published than immediately there was a response from China, which gives you a measure of how aware the Chinese are of what's going on in the rest of the world, and indeed an invitation to publish the book in Mandarin. And so part of the reason for my going to China was to meet the editors and publishers of the book. It was a very exciting trip for me, a real adventure, and an immersion into a society which, in a way, in the West, people are not really familiar with. And I was amazed at what I saw in China, in the sense of this, certainly in these two cities, an ultra-modernity. An incredible level of modernity that you see in these cities, that in a way they put things Canadian in the shadow. The advance is so spectacular that it is literally breathtaking. I guess while trying to figure out what I saw, I would say that what one saw was a gigantic capitalism in this society, on a scale that when you think that China is four or five times the size of the United States, has a disciplined and educated and sophisticated workforce, it seemed pretty clear to me that the center of the world's economy will inescapably move to China. China will be the center of the world economy in the coming decades. That is really the new reality that the world faces. So I said there was this gigantic capitalism, but I think I would also argue that this gigantic monumental capitalism is subordinated to the Chinese state structure, and that it is contained within a state structure which in its ideology, and the fact that it is dominated by the Communist Party, and the fact that the great enterprises of the society, the great enterprises, the banking and system, are in the public sector. I would say that socialism still dominates over capitalism in that society. So you have this remarkable capitalism, but still contained within a kind of framework that is socialist in some sense. Now, having said that, I would also say that this is a society which has serious problems. It has serious problems, the foremost of which is the ecological problem. I mean, it is astonishing that in a city like Nanjing, but especially in Beijing, the fact is that people have to wear masks in order to go about their business, that breathing is actually difficult. And Winnipeg may be backward, but the air is still breathable in a place like Winnipeg. In a city like Beijing, it's really questionable. And they said to me, you know, we haven't seen the sun in months, statements like that. And so there is this extremely serious ecological problem. They are quite aware of it, and they say it is getting better, but I couldn't see very much sign of that, to tell the truth. I think it's an extremely, they have to address this. Otherwise, people will simply perish. It's a question of overdevelopment that has emerged. And beyond that, I mean, this is the most serious problem, but this is a society which, in the cities at least, the infrastructure, the highways and so on are highly developed, way more than any place I know of in Canada. And certainly, if you look at the roads in Winnipeg, they're pitiful compared to what we see in a place like China. The traffic jams are on the scale of Los Angeles and even worse. And so the whole question of the automobile and the development of the automobile, a decision which was made in the late 1970s to develop the automobile industry, where they've been very successful. But the long-term implications of transportation by automobile, to my way of thinking, it seems to be a mistake to have done that. They might have done something more interesting in the way of public transport. So the ecological problem, the car problem, the fact that this is a very old market society, but as a result of their economic success, these people are literally drowning in commodities. You cannot believe the level of consumption of commodities in Chinese society. It's just every kind of commodity you can think of is on sale in China. There's a kind of fetishism of commodities in the society, I would say, and seems to be a basic a contradiction with any sense of socialism. Added to which, I would say the visible inequality in the society, the rejection of Maoism after 1978, and inequalities on an important scale have reemerged in society. So I would say these are some of the contradictions of this so-called socialism. Finally, I would note that China has a very long tradition of very strong centralized government. And I think that what you see in China today in this post-revolutionary society is a reassertion of that very strong centralist tradition. And one has to ask the question of, I mean, when I speak about socialism, I mean democracy. That it's not merely a question of public ownership. It's also public ownership on the basis of democratic governance seems to be fundamental to any sense of socialism. And although one shouldn't dismiss the legitimacy of the Chinese Communist Party, nevertheless, the absence of democratic input, it seems to me, is also evident in the society. So I'm saying that, yes, there is a kind of socialism in China, but it's a socialism which is problematic. Now, I thought that it would be interesting to say all these things. And I would note that I did have an interesting incident at the Renmin University. I gave this graduate seminar on my book, and at the end there were all sorts of questions, but there was this Maoist present. I mean, in the old sense, a Maoist, and he asked some interesting questions. First of all, he said, this guy apparently is the editor of a Maoist newspaper in Beijing. And he asked me, do you think China is socialist? And secondly, he asked, what do you think of the Cultural Revolution? So I answered, I said that China was socialist in the sense I've described socialism. I said, yes, I thought it was socialist in its framework. And I thought, secondly, that the Cultural Revolution, as I understood it, was a democratizing movement. Well, at the end of the lecture, the professor, who's my host, he said to me, you shouldn't say these things. You shouldn't say these things. He cautioned me. He didn't come down on me hard, but he said that people who say these things in China, say foreign scholars, are frequently not invited back to China. That was his caution. So I would say furthermore that this same professor is very aware of the restrictions. Over lunch, he, and especially the students are fantastic. They're hugely aware of their own country and the rest of the world, and very sophisticated, and sort of understand what I've described. These are the parameters in which they're working in, and they explain it to me, and there's a back and forth about it. There's a free discussion of all of this. Like the woman who was one of the students who was guiding us around in Beijing is doing a a thesis on the economic thought of the present leader. And she said, well, yes, I'm doing this. It's necessary to do this. But of course, I have my own thoughts on the matter, which I'm reserving for myself. I'm not talking about it in this thesis because it's necessary. So that's the situation. Now, having said all this, I'm not that enthusiastic about Canada either. I could make a huge parenthesis and talk about what's going on in this country and how screwed up it is. You know, in my opinion, it's a really screwed up place, Canada. So, I'm reporting back about China, but I'm not, dismissing China and therefore conclude, Canada is all right, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not prepared to say anything like that because I'm equally critical or even more critical about what's going on in this country. I'm just trying to give you a reasoned, more or less objective account of what I found in China. So I would say, now coming back to the book, the last thing I want to say is that I did say in this talk, I said that China is going to be the center of the world economy. Well, I do discuss that toward the end of this book. And by sheer agglomeration, 1.3 billion people, highly trained, highly educated, and so on, that's the way things are going to move. And I would say that in some way there is a certain justice to that because it really returns the situation to what it was in 1500. We're seeing a reassertion of, in terms of the world economy, the hegemony of China, which was the great economy, world economy, prior to the emergence of capitalism in the West after 1500. So in a way, there is a kind of circularity to what is happening. So now to come to the book itself, I would offer the book to you because I think that it is a historical account, but it's a historical account which is, I've tried to theorize the history in this book. It's not merely both a work of history and a political economy. It tries to do both, and it is based on the latest scholarship about these matters. You know, I think it's very up to date. It's within a small compass. I think it's written in a comprehensible way, and as I say, it combines both a kind of historical account and gives you some sense of the theory that is necessary to understand what capitalism is all about. Now, in terms of the overall structure of the book, I basically it's divided into four historical parts, and then there is a kind of conclusion. The four historical parts are based on first these four stages of capitalism. The first stage is merchant capitalism, which is the longest period of capitalism, between about 1500 and 1780. And it's a period in which capitalism based on wage labor existed, but where I would say the economic growth was still relatively limited during this whole period. This is the longest period. Following which, of course, there was the Industrial Revolution when capital actually entered into the productive process. And this period of the Industrial Revolution lasted between 1780 and roughly 1880, and was largely centered in the West. Then there followed between 1880 and I would say 1914, the period of monopoly capitalism and imperialism between 1880 and the First World War. And then the last period, the period of late capitalism between the First World War and the present. And it was marked, first of all, by a kind of civil war between 1914 and 1945. Then it was marked by a period of very strong consumer capitalism. And then from 1980 onwards, the period of neoliberalism, under which we continue to live right down to the present. So there are these four stages of capitalism. And then the concluding section of the book in detail describes what I consider to be the crisis of capitalism, which fully broke out about 2008 and continues to the present. And I believe that this crisis is in fact a mortal crisis. I don't see capitalism. There's so many problems that have developed in capitalism, have emerged in capitalists since 2008. I don't see how capitalism can basically recover from the situation it finds. So my basic contention in the book is that we're looking at a system which is basically dying and will continue to die. Finally, I talk about the alternative, that is to say, socialism. And in the last part of the book, I basically try to describe what socialism, how socialism can develop, may possibly develop, and how it might work. I outline that. One of my reviewers, Ian Angus, has given me an excellent review. I recommend his review because it's so excellent. He points to, he says that, you know, this is very unusual for a historian to come right out with the idea that to actually sort of try to envision the future. It's something that professional historians usually eschew, usually stay away from, but I plunge right ahead and based on intelligent things that have been written about the future, I talk about what might be the future beyond capitalism, namely the arrival of socialism. So what capitalism is? Well, capitalism is both, and this was already said by Marx, so capitalism is both a set of social relations and also it's a global system. It's both of these things simultaneously. So the basic framework is that I do go into the social relations of capitalism, but I also insist on the fact that the system was from the beginning a world system, and both of those things are necessary. In particular, I make a big thing of the fact of the circulation of money, which is necessary in terms of the whole process of accumulation of capital. The money form is essential to that, and I point to the fact that the money of capitalism is not European. It comes from Latin America, this money. And so I underline that in terms of stressing the fact that this is a global system that we're talking about. This money makes possible exchange on a world scale, the Americas, but at the same time, Asia is connected by this money system that emerges from the 16th century onwards. So I stress that point a lot, as well as, of course, the so-called social relations of capitalism based on wage labor and the existence on the one hand and capitalists on the other. But I also say that from the beginning, capitalism based itself on inequality and disregard of nature. That was true from the very beginning. Nature was disregarded, and there was a lot of ecological damage even from the earliest days of capitalism. But it didn't matter so much because nature seemed to be a free good for generations and indeed for centuries. So there was inequality and ecological damage, and in effect, ecological damage has now caught up with us, and we find ourselves in a growing impasse. So let me speak a little bit about the capitalist crisis that we're in. I want to say something about that. So what is this capitalist crisis? Well, a capitalist crisis can start from the economy, the capitalist economy that we're living in under now. There's a certain morosity, there's a certain permanent stagnation that has developed within the economy, a lack of growth, lack of oomph within the world economy. And this seems to be a permanent condition. It's now more than a decade where this has been the case, and it seems to be a continuing feature. And economists basically now speak about something about permanent low growth. Well, capitalism has always developed, has always depended on real growth and so on. And this stagnation is one of the features of this crisis. But, of course, also the incredible social inequalities developed inside it. Everybody knows about the 1%, and it's a reality. It's a reality all over the world. More and more of the wealth is concentrated at the top, and the great mass of people have trouble basically making a living, and there is an incredible gap which has opened up and which seems to be a permanent feature of this period that we're living with, and no real interest really in terms of the governing elites and so on in addressing this problem. So I say economic stagnation, huge discrepancies, diversity between the rich and the poor, the growing sense of the population that the government is unwilling and unable to address these problems, and therefore what is set in is a growing skepticism on the part of populations all over the world about the elites who govern these societies and the governments of the so-called democratic countries, democratic capitalist countries. Who are these people? And the system doesn't seem to work anymore. And what's the point of voting? And what is this all about? A great questioning is developed within society about the legitimacy of a so-called representative democracy. It's not so apparent in Canada. We only have these bizarre the politics of now, but if you look at the United States, or you look at what people in Europe think about their governments, to say nothing about places like Latin America or Africa and so on, there's a widespread basically rejection of the governing elites right through the capitalist world that has taken place. So an economic crisis, a social divide, a sense of political illegitimacy has set in. And then, of course, there is the fact of imperialism, permanent war seems to be a feature of the society that we're living in, this the world that we're living in. Permanent war, of which Canada is very much a part. Let's be very clear about that. Canada is an imperialist country. It is militarized. The military have a huge play. The military and the intelligence systems in Canada are highly developed, and they function all over the world, and they are repressing people all through the world, and they're repressing the Canadian people as well, who are under permanent surveillance, it seems to me. So if you take this all in all, and you look at particularly the country which is supposed to be the leader of the capitalist world, we notice that this crisis that I've described, the center of this crisis is actually the United States of America. It's in the United States of America where all of these things are felt most acutely, and where you do see tremendous malaise, social and political malaise that developed in the United States. And even in that country, not in Canada, but in that country, especially amongst the young, the feeling has begun to develop that the answer is socialism. It seems almost paradoxical, the most capitalist country in the world. It's there that we see that socialist thought is actually burgeoning in the population. And even mainline politicians that are not very particularly radical and so on, they have begun to speak about socialism, democratic socialism, which is another term for social democracy in Canadian terms. So those are some of the things that the book is about. But in the final chapters of the book, I stress that the answer, of course, is socialism. I argue in the book that you cannot arrive at socialism through elections. Elections are necessary, are useful and important processes, but you're not going to end the system of capitalist property by elections. You will have to rip that property from the hands of the people who control it. The small number of people, that is to say in Canada, estimated at something like 1,200 families basically dominate the Canadian economy. You have to take it out of their hands. That means revolution as the way change is going to take place. And for revolution to take place, you need a revolutionary party. You need a party of revolution. You cannot have, you need leadership. Now, this leadership has to be as democratic as possible, but it also has to be committed to the idea, to a revolutionary project. Otherwise, you will never put an end to capitalism. So I say these things in the book. I also say that the capitalism that we have now is in fact pregnant with socialism. There are many features of the current system that lend themselves to the reorganization of economic and political life and the introduction of socialism. One of the things that is present in our lives is the planning process. We live in a planned economy. Governments plan, institutions like universities plan, all corporations and businesses plan, and the planning, in fact, process has become extremely sophisticated under capitalism. Obviously, computerization has helped that process, but I try to show in the book the degree to which this society is already, in many of its aspects, a planned economy, so that the emergence of a fully a fully planned economy is not that great a step. So there's that. Now, finally, I want to conclude this by talking about the idea of progress, the idea of progress. That's a familiar idea. It's a shibboleth of capitalism, the first premonitions of which already were present in the Renaissance, way back in the 16th century. Some thinkers in the Renaissance already spoke about that history is not about endless cycles, but in fact there is a progressive element to history. And then, of course, in the 18th century, this idea of progress developed strongly. In the 18th century and the 19th century, it became basically the ideology of the bourgeois class who ruled under capitalism. It was a fundamental idea. And the question arises, given what I've described, given the crisis I've described, what becomes of the idea of progress if you put an end to capitalism and introduce socialism? Well, based on the thought of a very distinguished Marxist, Metzeris, I would say that the idea of progress can't continue. It can't continue under capitalism because capitalism has fallen into this deep crisis. And we know that there is just a generalized deep pessimism that, in fact, grips public opinion in the world that we live in. So in what sense can there be progress? Well, I would say under socialism, there can be progress. The progress will mean basically an end to exchange values, an end to endless economic growth and exchange. But what Marx referred to as use values can continue, and in fact, with the end of capitalism, can actually fully come into its own. Use values can come into their own. That is what I say, use values. That is to say, respect and enjoyment of nature, music, art, leisure, social life, the development of a better social life. These are what Marx described as use values rather than exchange values. Under socialism, liberated from the thrall, from the chains of basically economy based on commodities and the possession of commodities, these use values, that these essentially human values, can flourish as never before. So on that optimistic note, I'll conclude my remarks and offer you this talk.